Next session, I'll just move the cushion to the floor. Then I'm still, you can still see me, but this feels awkward. It's so hard. Okay. So let's start with a few moments of meditation. First, some breathing meditation, and then I'll guide you through just a few moments of setting your motivation. And then after that, we do the prayers. You decide which prayers, like to do Heart Sutra, and then of course, Refuge Bodhicitta, and whichever else you feel comfortable doing. So let's just settle down to meditate. First, just mindfulness of the breath. To let go of any disruptive thoughts, worries, and so forth. To set your motivation. I think that we will use this time, the next 2.5 days, to learn about one of the most important texts in the Nanda tradition of Buddhism. Not just for your own benefit, but for the benefit of all other sentient beings. Experiencing most horrendous sufferings. Because of not understanding reality as it is. So may our study and contemplation of Nagarjuna's text become a cause for our own enlightenment able to lead all of the sentient beings to that awakened state. Really feel that from the depth of your heart. Okay, so let's do the prayers.
המנטרה המשתווה למה שאין שווה לו, המנטרה המשתינה כליל שווה וחוסר כליל, משום שהיא שאלה שקרית, דשמנתי, ממש למות החוכמה מנתה. תלה תלה, גת ידעתי, פרסנתי, פרסנתי, בודי סומה. שרקותותה, על הבנוסף המעשת ולהתאמן כך לשלמות החוכמה מנתה. ואז יצא הבן אדם מהניצוב המדיקטיבי הזה, ונסע מנות
שבח ובניסת במעשת
והאור ובשבר העבר עצמן.
טוב מאוד, טוב מאוד, ולשושל את זה כך.
ולשושל את זה כך. יש לעשות לשלמות החוכמה מנתה, כפי שציינת להם, ואתה תהג את מוכבים תמיכו בכך. משנהנית הבן אדם את אמירתו כך,
סמכו שרקו מהנכבל,
הבריסה במסעת העל הרבה ובשבר העבר עצמה. הסובבים האלה כולם, בצורף הישויות השניות,
בני האנוש,
הישויות השניות גם בחצר, ועל גם בהרבה, ושיקחו את שעבר העבר. בבונה בדרמה ובגילה אליי, אבקש נקלט עד להערה. באמצעות המצבורים של מנגנות ובדרמה, לא עשית מודעיות כדי לא יהיה לצורים המודדים.
בבונה בדרמה ובגילה אליי, אבקש נקלט עד להערה.
באמצעות המצבורים של הקשבה לדרמה, לא עשית מודעיות כדי לא יהיה לצורים המודדים. בבונה בדרמה ובגילה אליי, אבקש נקלט עד להערה. באמצעות המצבורים של השכבה לדרמה, לא עשית מודעיות כדי לא יהיה לצורים המודדים.
לא יזכו כל בעלי התודעה בראש השם ובגורם הישר. לא יפרדו כל בעלי התודעה בסבב ובגורם הישר. לא לעולם לא יפרדו כל בעלי התודעה בראש השם נטול כאב. לא יפתחו כל בעלי התודעה את מידת ההשתברות ללא לעשות פנים של התקשרות ושל סיום. Just because it helps everyone else who's here.
motivated enough, be present, be focused. It always makes a difference in terms of the group energy. So therefore, try to be on time and come to every session. Okay, great. So, might as well just kind of start with the text, because it's really difficult. It's actually one of the most difficult texts and the most important texts on emptiness. As you can see at the beginning of this booklet, it says that when His Holiness teaches this particular text, because, I mean, it's too many chapters to actually teach in one go, I mean, even if His Holiness, I mean, no longer teaches for 14, 15 days, but even if He did, it would be very difficult to finish, which is why His Holiness chose, usually it's four chapters that His Holiness teaches of those, of the whole entire text. And I've added two more that His Holiness also sometimes adds. But usually it's chapter 26, 18, 24, and 1. Right, yeah, those are the chapters His Holiness usually teaches. And His reasoning is that it kind of includes the most important ideas, those chapters 26, 18, 24, and 1. It includes the most important chapters and gives you a good sense of what the text is all about. And then the other chapters, you just go into more details on what was explained in those four chapters. And like I said, in one of the teachings and also other teachings, there were verse 1 added 23 and 22. So 23 is quite difficult. But the most difficult chapter, is chapter 1. And apparently in texts, Indian texts that were originally composed in Sanskrit, it's known that the first chapter, it's traditional that the first chapter is the most difficult one. You start with the most difficult ideas. Yeah, I think a whiteboard is not a bad idea. I'll see how it goes, but I may have to use the whiteboard. The most difficult chapter, you go through it first, and without being discouraged, not understanding much, you then continue with the following chapters in order then to understand what was taught in the first chapter. But here, His Holiness took it to the end, teaches this chapter to the, at the end, which makes it easier for us. All right. And then, of course, not missing is the verse of homage. The very beginning of this text, Nagarjuna, before he composed the different chapters, he composed what's called a verse of homage, kind of basically being grateful, paying his respects to the Buddha. Different objects of homage are given or are chosen, depending on what the subject matter is, etc. But here it's the Buddha himself, but it's actually mainly dependent arising, so saying, well, thank you very much, Buddha. You taught the dependent arising. It's very helpful. So paying homage to dependent arising, I mean to the Buddha because of dependent arising, but explaining dependent arising at the same time. So Nagarjuna, who's the author of this text, was a very important Indian Nalanda master, Nalanda monastic university master. And after him, there was, for instance, someone called Chandrakirti, who wrote a commentary on this text, two commentaries in fact. One where he explained the words of this text, like a word commentary, and another one in which he explained the meaning, more focusing on the meaning. Have you heard of those two texts? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Yes? Yeah, so one is called Clear Words, if you use the English title, that's the explanation of the words. And then the other one is called Entry into the Middle Way. And in the beginning, in the clear words, Chandrakirti says that these first verses here, the first verses on the homage, the verses of homage, they actually explain the subject matter of the entire text, dependent arising. And it also talks about the ultimate purpose. What is the purpose of this text? So first, in the first few lines, that which is dependent arising, that's the subject matter of this text, which is briefly mentioned. without ceasing, without being generated. Okay? Without annihilation, without permanence, without coming, without going, without being different, without being one. So those are eight attributes. So of course, Dvaita already has endless attributes. The fact that everything is dependent on something else. So dependent arising. Dependent arising is actually a funny word. I think in English we would use a different word. We would use the word interdependence, which works just as well. Whether you say dependent arising or interdependence, means the same thing. That whatever exists in dependence on other things. Or it's interdependent. Like two things are interdependent, phenomena are interdependent. But why do we say dependent arising? Well, it stresses the fact that things have not always been there, that phenomena come into existence and go out of existence with regard to the sense objects, the objects we enjoy on a daily basis, the objects we think about. In general, they're mostly impermanent, they change moment by moment. And so therefore they come into existence at some point and they go out of existence at another point. So therefore they arise. So how do they arise? Well, independence on other things. So dependent arising, or as it's also sometimes called, dependent origination. Just because the Tibetan word for arising can also be translated as originate. Whether you say originate or arise, it's basically saying it comes into existence independence on other things. That's really what it means. And it means more than that. In Tibetan in particular, the word dingjingjiaozhongwa, it means it arises independence and in relation to other things. So it's connected to other things. It's dependent on other things and it's connected to other things. And that is the way other phenomena exist. And we may think, well, big deal, I knew that, but not really. The way I look at it is our mind has so many different levels. So there's the coarse intellectual kind of mind, and there is the mind that is deeper. Deeper in the sense of harder to recognize, more in touch with your mind, or more connecting to the emotions, and much more important. So our problem is oftentimes intellectually we know everything is interdependent, but deep within it feels like, nah. Feels like, no, they have their own entity, they exist somehow on their own and just a little bit dependent. It's weird when you watch your own mind how there's a sense, yes, it exists in and of itself as this, that, and the other, and on top of that, exists a little bit of independence. Right? So we're not very consistent with our sense of interdependence because we believe something is in and of itself already a table or a chair. And I'll walk into this room and the reason I see it, the reason I perceive it or apprehend it, is because it is already a chair or it is already colored blue. Red, what have you. From a Buddhist point of view, it's the other way around. It is blue, it is a chair, because we apprehended it to be one. See? Direct opposite. But that is very hard for us to recognize that we're kind of perceiving things in that opposite way, such that our mind, deep within, feels it exists, the object exists as what they appear to us, it's got nothing to do with us. It's always been like that, and I just see it for what it is. That's how deep within our mind perceives things as such. Intellectually, we may believe, oh yeah, beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. Yeah. Things exist in dependence on other things. But then we catch ourselves thinking, this person likes that? How weird are they? They like that kind of music? They're really weird. They like this kind of job or whatever. There's something wrong with them. So we catch ourselves thinking there's something, because there's a sense this is in and of itself. itself beautiful, is in and of itself desirable, good, bad, and what have you, and if other people don't see it, well, there's something wrong with them. I may not see it yet. Or one of the few, whatever. Therefore, this shows that although we believe in the interdependence, it makes sense to us, that belief is on a more intellectual level. It doesn't come from deep within, and so our actions are not influenced by the fact, for instance, that my happiness is dependent on everyone else's happiness. And I'm really not interested in anyone else's happiness. I'm interested mainly in my own. Right? So therefore, that's a sign for the fact that, yeah, I have some idea of I'm dependent on others, but then again, not. So we're very inconsistent when it comes to dependent arising. And not just us, a lot of philosophers, mainly Indian philosophers, are quite inconsistent. So when we study Nagarjuna's explanation, actually Buddha's explanation, of course, but then clarified by Nagarjuna, when we study what's called emptiness and dependent arising, which are not that different, it's just looking at the same thing from a different perspective. When we study this, we study also other philosophers. Because this is so hard to understand that to jump right away into this subject matter can be very challenging. It's helpful to take a step-by-step approach and even learn some of the non-Buddhist philosophers. Maybe go, why would I do that? I want to learn about Buddhism. I'm not going to learn about someone called Vaisheshika philosopher or Samkhya philosopher or whatever else philosopher. But it's so helpful. Why? Because our wrong views, our contradictory views, which we're not aware of, they are laid out as a whole philosophy. So you learn about them, and you first go, all non-Buddhist philosophy. And then after a while you go, but they kind of make sense. Why? Because that's the view we actually also hold. I mean, when we learn about them, we don't learn about all their views, but about the views that stand in contradiction to dependent arising, in contradiction to emptiness. So these views we study, and as you learn about them, you notice that you hold these on, we hold these views ourselves. And they help us to become aware of these views. And then, once you've done that, once as part of this study, as part of philosophical study, we learn about a little bit, to a certain degree. Like, for instance, right now I'm working on a text called the Pramanavartika. A lot of time is spent discussing with the Chanakas, the Buddhist, the non-Buddhist hedonists, if you like, who hold very powerful, very sophisticated philosophy. They're not just hedonists, they actually were very, they were philosophers, basically, who believed only in the things that they saw. And then there were the Samkhyas, they come up here, the Vaisheshikas, etc. So, different philosophers, and their kind of philosophy, we learn about that, and that's the first step, getting to know like an extreme view on reality that we actually all hold. So it allows us to become aware of that. And then we go into the other philosophies, into the other Buddhist philosophies. So Buddhist philosophies that are not considered to be the highest philosophies. And again, they talk about interdependence, all right, but they're not going all the way. They're inconsistent. They say, yes, things exist interdependently, but also in and of themselves. Again, that's how we think. We are walking contradictions. As in, like, our mind holds a lot of contradictory views. In one moment, yes, we're dependent on other things, we're interdependent. In the next moment, yeah, but not in that way. Not there, etc. Okay? A lot of contradictions. We're not aware. So we hold a lot of contradictory views, a lot of them not in accordance with reality. And of course, if we're not in accordance with reality, if our view of how things work, how everything exists, does not accord with